Hello everyone and welcome to the first EU Datathon webinar this year. My name is Julia Zagrodzka and I work at the Publications Office of the European Union. EU Datathon is an annual open data competition organized by the Publications Office, and this year the finals of the competition will take place during the online EU Open Data Days in November, right after the EU Dataviz, and free and online open data and data visualization conference. To start with, I will quickly guide you through the website of the EU Datathon and briefly explain the rules of the competition, but of course you may check them in more detail on the website yourselves. Now, how to participate in the EU Datathon? Well, the first step is very simple. All you need to do is send us a description of an idea for an application, so you don't need a fully developed app at this stage yet. And this app should refer to one of the three thematic challenges which are listed here: a European Green Deal, an economy that works for people, or a Europe fit for the digital age. These three challenges are aligned with the priorities of the European Commission. Apart from this thematic requirement, your application should also use at least one open data set from the platform data.europa.eu and be combined with another data set or data sets, open data sets from any other source. You may apply as an individual or in a team of up to four people. You can also apply as a company or any other legal entity. You don't need to be an EU member state national to apply, as the competition is open to participants from all over the world. Now, the important thing is that the deadline to send us your description of the application is the 21st of May. So hurry up, because there is not so much time left. Once we will have gathered all the ideas, we will select three of them, three teams per each challenge. And we will invite those teams to develop their ideas into fully functional apps this time. Then these fully functional apps will be presented by the teams during the finals, as I mentioned before, online during the EU Open Data Days in November. Then at the final event, the jury will appoint the winners, who will receive the following financial prizes listed here, depending on the final ranking. But as you see, there are three prizes for each challenge, which means that all the finalists will receive an award. If you have any questions to us, feel free to contact us directly using the email provided here on the website. You can also reach out to us via social media channels. Now, let's move on to the webinar of today. Just a quick remark before, you will find all the recordings of the webinars here in the webinars tab of the website. Not only the webinars of this year's edition, but also all the previous webinars. So feel free to take a look, browse, and get inspired, because this is the purpose of the webinars: to get some inspiration and to find out about the data sets which correspond to the thematic challenges. Our today's guest is Ryan McSherry from the European Environment Agency, who will present you some data sets which you might want to use when addressing the first challenge, a European Green Deal. Ryan, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Julia. My name is Brian McSherry. I work for the European Environment Agency, and we're very happy to work with our colleagues in the Commission on the EU Datathon 2021. What I'll do is give a very short presentation on one of the key data sets to be used for the EU Green Deal, and that is the Natura 2000 data set on protected areas. So I'm just going to give a presentation here. Let me just quickly share my screen as we wait for this to share here now. And I hope you can see my screen now, and I'll just put it into presentation mode, and that's going to slowly happen. Yes. So as I said, this is the EU Datathon, and the data set I'm going to discuss is the Natura 2000 protected area data set. So it's a network of 27,000 protected areas across the 27 EU member states, and it covers 18% of the land of Europe and 8% of the marine territory. See a very small map here on the screen to give you an idea of just how many of these different types of sites there are all across Europe. So you might ask yourself, well, why is this an interesting data set? Well, what it does is it's a protected area data set, but it doesn't just tell you where sites are. it also crucially tells you what species and habitats are in those sites, what they protect. So, you know, for the technical aspect, we have a spatial data set with a tabular data set that's linked. And it gives you this information on the name, it gives you a description about the site, it tells you this list of the species, the list of the habitats. There's also some user reference documents I'll tell you about later on in the presentation. So if you're using the data set, maybe a few kind of tips on how to use it. What I think are some of the nice, easiest to use pieces of information are the site name, which tells you the name of the site. There is a site code, which is a unique code for the site, and you can use that to link it to different tables in the database. For example, there's a habitat field, and it tells you about the name of the habitat type. This is like forest or wetlands or bogs or mountain areas, and it's got a code for it. There's also then a table on species, and it gives you the name of the species, but also the grouping of them. So are they birds? Are they mammals? Are they plants, etc.? And then there's a little thing which is called the quality. It really tells you a bit about the site. You know, it explains that this is a site in, say, Ireland, where I'm from. It tells you a bit why it's a special site, filled in by the park manager of the area. Maybe you want to say, well, what does this really look like? So here's one or two quick slides. So this is a map of Europe. You can see a lot of green in this map for all the different protected areas. As I said, there's over 27,000 of them. You can see some very large ones here. And again, what you can do with the spatial data set, you can zoom in. For example, this is an area in the west coast of Ireland, which I know quite well. You can identify one particular site we can see here in purple. But you can see all the different sites that are related to it and connected to it. And I mentioned earlier on that there is a database. Here's what it looks like if I open it in, say, Access database. You can see a few different tables in here, and there's different connections about this. And you might say, well, that looks good, but maybe show me what it can tell you if I look at one site. So if I zoom into the site I showed you a minute ago, this is a site I know very well. It's one of my favorite areas in Europe. It's called Burn in the west of Ireland. And when you look at it, it tells you the list of the habitat types. You can see here we've got freshwater and grasslands and bogs and mires and rocky habitats. Gives you the name of them, a bit more of the technical name. It also tells you that there's 14 species in here that are protected. You can see there's a lot of bird species, the Latin name, the common name, and you can see there's two mammal species and invertebrate species. So this is really what this database tells you. You can look at a site and you can figure out how many habitats, how many species are protected. And the interesting thing as well is that this is the same list of habitats and species that are used across those 27 different countries. So you could then say, what can I do with this site? You could do a number of different things. Here is just a few examples. You could map all the protected areas that have certain species in them. How many sites occur near you? And if so, what species and habitats are in those sites? You know, are there certain species or habitats located in specific regions? Are they near the coast? Are they in mountains? What kind of land use is happening within these sites and outside of these sites? As I said, this is one of the key data sets that we use for assessing the progress of the EU Green Deal. You might then ask yourself what data sets I could use or link to this. I would say any spatial data set could be used to connect it, because it's a spatial data set. You can then do your connections between things. You can bring different layers in and do your analysis. Any questions? I meant a typo in here. This should refer to my next slide, which I'll give you some more information. And then how often is the data set updated? It's updated every single year. We update it normally about February of every year. And I'm going to show you a link in two slides time that gives you the latest version of the data set. If you want to read a bit more, there's a link here to the Natura 2000 page on the Commission's website. It gives you a bit of information here, a bit of a nutshell, tells you about practice, gives you a bit of the information on different aspects of it. And crucially, there's a frequently asked question guide on Natura 2000. And thankfully, it comes in a variety of different languages. So if you want to understand this data set a bit more, go to this web page. You can click on the frequently asked questions and get a bit more information about it. With the data set itself, you can access it via a few different places. One area is on the European Environment Agency's website. And what I also have in this presentation is a few maybe useful resources to understand the data set a bit more. So you can download the data from this website here. If you want to understand the data set, there's some links here that tell you what these different tables mean. You know, the often tables have different acronyms, so this explains it in simple language. And then if you want to understand the different the reasons why we have these different tables and what they mean or what they do not mean. There's another resource here, which is this Natura 2000 help page in there. So please check these links out. You can follow up with us online as well and see what's happening. You can do some Googling to see what the Natura 2000 data sets are. But I should say it is one of the key protected area and biodiversity data sets that exist in Europe. And it's also, the nice thing about it is every country in Europe works together to create these sites. So a person in Spain, a person in Finland, a person in Ireland or Italy, they're all working in a common way to create these sites. So you can do your analysis and you can start seeing what happens across Europe for this. So thank you very much for listening, and I hope you have good success in your challenges. Thank you very much. Was that okay?
Julia, would you mind if I kick it off with a question?
Sure, go ahead with questions, Simon.
Brian, thanks a lot for the presentation. Maybe not everyone of our participants is so familiar with the European Green Deal. Would you mind giving one to census what it is about?
I will assess how we look at the environment in Europe. It's groundbreaking for those who work in the environmental sphere, ways we can have a positive or negative impact. And what we're trying to do with the Green Deal is sit down and see how we can coordinate this. And one of the key aspects of this is the EU Biodiversity Strategy, which sets out some nice ambitious targets of what we should be doing to protect the environment in Europe and also restore the environment in Europe.
Great, thanks a lot. I would have another question. Is there a way with this data set to check maybe for corruption or for non-authorized land use, or?
Yes, it's a good question, Simon. So what we have at the European Environment Agency, we have a variety of different data sets. And if you go and check our website, you can start finding a lot of different areas in there. But we do use a lot of Copernicus satellite data to create some land use data sets. And we can also use it to track different activities that are happening. We make these data sets freely available so you can start using them in there. I should say in general, if people start noticing illegal activities, as you were mentioning, you can always contact the European Commission and submit a note, and then they can do an assessment of that. It's called a formal process, an infringement process. So if you're at a Natura 2000 site, for example, you see some illegal activity happening, as a citizen in the EU, you can always contact the European Union, report this, and then they'll investigate it then with the relevant authorities. But we do have a lot of satellite imagery to try and help us.
In your domain, how would you see this data set best reused? I mean, what kind of applications do you have in mind that could benefit from such data?
Very good question, Mari. I think there's a lot you could do with this. I mean, I think it depends on how you want to look at it. I mean, a few things that come to mind are maybe educational. You have a local school. Where's the nearest protected area to your school? What are the species? What are the habitats in that area? You could also then start seeing if you have a bird species, for example. You know, the bird species moves across Europe, and what sites across Europe are for that one species of bird. So what you're seeing then is if you see a particular bird in your site, you could look at that. You could create a application where you say, I've seen a certain bird. Show me all the sites across Europe where that species occurs. And suddenly you're going from maybe your back garden or 1 or 2 kilometers away from you live, your school, and you see suddenly you're exposed to all of Europe. And that's just one example. Other ones could be, urban areas in and around protected areas, you know, access to green space. We've noticed with COVID-19 and the pandemic, people are really beginning to realize that it's very important to go out into nature and to, you know, have that kind of release valve. You know, where's my nearest site? What species, what habitats are in there? Can I record them? Can I see them? Also, you could start looking at maybe potential linkages between air pollution or water quality. Is the fact that the water quality is good in an area due to the fact there's a protected area in the region? It could be something like that. We also have a lot of information on water quality for bathing, for swimming. You know, you could see what's the linkage between a protected area and maybe better quality of water in there. I think a lot depends on where you want to look at. You could see, are there roads in and around protected areas where there's forestry? My area is very much from a biodiversity perspective, so my examples are always about this. I must say I have used this data set before to plan kayaking and cycling trips. So could be maybe a bit of a unique aspect, but I remember once I was kayaking in the UK, and as I was paddling around, I was able to tell everybody what species were in the area I was seeing, and say, "Oh, did you know that this is actually the most important breeding ground for a certain type of dolphin in Europe?"
I love the freshness of your ideas. Really, really, I just love them. Okay, I have a more mundane question to follow. I was wondering, you mentioned an access database. I was wondering, in what formats is this data set available, and does it have any, is it semantically annotated also? What's the, in what ways could people reuse it?
Good question. So I should say the data set is available. We'll put the link probably on this webinar somewhere, but it's available in two formats. There's a tabular database, which I think, as you mentioned, the Access one. That's downloaded as an Access database, which is a Microsoft product that you can use in a variety of different applications. But it's also then available as what we call a CSV or comma separated value data set. It's a zipped file because it's quite large, but you can download and access in that regard. The spatial data is available in three different formats. There is a shapefile, and if you use GIS, you'll know what that means. If you don't use GIS, you'd be like, I'm sorry, I have no idea what you're talking about. Also, for the GIS people out there, there's a geo package, which is a standard format. It's an Open Geospatial Consortium standard, which means there is a lot of people have discussed how it should look like, what it should be, what the quality control of it all is. So it's a way people across the world can use a certain file format and know they can reuse it in different ways. And also what we do is we make sure that it's compliant to what we call the Inspire Directive, which is a standard from the European Union about explaining the structure of it, ensuring that it's not a case that every year I decide, no, we're going to change it like this, we're going to change it like this. So we make sure that the data is in a very technically very easy to use, that is robust, is quality controlled, is quality checked. And on our website, we have a lot of information about what the processes we've done for that, and then what we call the metadata around it, like, which is information about information. So it should be in a variety of formats that it should be relatively easy to use for people. And I should say as well, this spatial data is available as a digital web service as well. Again, if you use GIS, you'll know exactly what I mean. If you don't use GIS, don't worry about that.
Thank you very much, Ren.
I may to ask just one last question.
Please, Julia.
A bit linked to the previous question of Maria. Are you aware of, do you have like an overview of already existing applications which use this data set?
I know at the agency we discussed creating an application before that you could use your mobile phone to find the nearest site for you. It was a bit of a test we did, and I don't think we really followed through at the very end because we got busy doing lots of different things. I know some people have talked before about linking it to some of the exercise apps as well. So, if you're doing your mountain biking or cycling, are you going through a protected area or not? But I've heard of people discussing it. I haven't seen it being used in different apps. Maybe my app usage is getting quite bad in my slightly older age.
Thank you.
Brian, one more question. We always encourage our teams not to create like a one-off application and then set it and forget it.
So what we are doing with the data is our plans are obviously we try to make sure that we improve the quality control of it constantly, so you're always assured you get good quality data coming in. What we will do going forward is we're going to change the structure, the information in the database a bit, because the EU Green Deal and the biodiversity strategy start asking for a bit more information than we've currently had before. So what we're doing is we're working with all the countries in Europe to work out what that means and how we could link it to the structure, the way we collect information at the moment. What we'll probably do is add some more information to the database. And again, if we do that, we'll have some documentation explaining what we've added, why we've added, what it means technically as well, what any kind of lookup tables, as we call them, would be. So that will add, that will be added to probably the data set, maybe in the next year or 2 years. But it's something we don't change it every year. When we do changes, we try to think ahead several years to see that we're, you know, creating something that's stable but not static, is how we've often described it. So we do changes when they're needed, but we don't try and change it every single year, because that would make it difficult for people who are using it. They'd have to go back in, check everything again, change what they're doing. But I think maybe in the next year or 2 years, you will see some changes where we're going to add additional information. And maybe one of those will be, but this site, we're specifically ask you what this site is for. What are the, what we call the conservation of habitats? So it's a lot of more, a bit more information. And I should flag as well that it's pretty unique to have a data set of protected areas with this level of information available at a global level. So it's a very rich data set, a lot of information in there. And I would point people to some of the references I've had to read about this, understand it as well. And if they have questions, read the FAQ document and maybe do a bit of Googling, read some of the reports we've written about it as well. So as I said, maybe in 2 years' time, there'll be a bit of a tweak, maybe 3 or 4 years' time, maybe another tweak, but not every year.